The second component of trust is intentions. Now, most of us don't really think about intentions when we think about trust, but in this segment, you're going to see why it's so critical to creating trusting relationships. I have to trust your intentions towards me if I'm going to trust you.
Now, this next one is intentions. We want to talk about that. What are intentions? What do we mean by that? Well, first we mean our motives. We need to evaluate and purify our motives. I am not going to trust you as a leader unless I believe your intentions are pure. Now, what would that actually be? I have to, again, go back to what we talked about in terms of trusting relationships. I have to believe that your goal is to have me succeed, that your objective is to have the organization succeed, and that you're not using me to climb the career ladder. You're not using me to look good. You're not using me to be an example to other people, that when you give me feedback, it's because you're actually trying to help me get better and not show me up or to make me feel stupid or to vent or any of those other things. I have to absolutely believe that you have my best interest at heart. And I'll tell you this, I one of my first jobs post-college, I don't want to say where, but I had a boss, and in our team meetings, all that happened, every team meeting, we had weekly meetings, she would show up, and the meetings only consisted of her telling us where we had messed up or where people had complained. Now, she would say, oh, this, I'm doing this for your own good. And yet none of us, there were four of us on that team, none of us believed that. None of us really felt as though her intentions were to really help us become better. It was to keep us in line, to demonstrate power over us. And so there was no trust. Certainly there was not good morale, but there was absolutely no trust because we did not trust her intentions. Okay, let me give you another example. I was rolling out a training, this is probably 3 or 4 years ago, at the Department of Health, and we were doing a training on a Tuesday after the Memorial Day holiday, and it had been dumping rain, and there was a leak in the training room there at the Department of Health. So, I walked in the room, and it was just like a punch in the face. It stunk so bad. Also, there was a dirty diaper that had been left in the room over that long weekend, okay, and just nasty trash for whatever reason that had not been taken out. So I was rolling out a new training when I had never presented before, and my boss showed up without my inviting him, without asking him to be there. My boss came and actually started getting things cleaned up, said, Dan, here, you worry about your presentation, your training. He took the garbage out. He went and got the janitorial staff and, you know, tried to get the smell fixed up, although sometimes that air freshener with the nasty stink kind of just makes things worse. But he was going out of his way to get these things fixed, even though he wasn't gonna get any recognition for it. His bosses weren't gonna say, "Well, you're such a good supervisor," or, you know, anything like that. At that moment, I felt some trust. I said, "His intentions here are for me to be successful." Do you see how that makes a trusting relationship? Absolutely critical. The other thing here I would say, and I'll take the same boss actually to give you an example, is under agenda. You need to publicize your intentions. And this is counterintuitive to a lot of us, but you need to be able to say, by the way, everyone, here's what I'm trying to do. Vocalize those things. Make them, announce them, make them clear so that you're clearing up any misconceptions. I currently have a couple of offices. I spend half my time in Draper, half my time in Salt Lake. Now, I live in Riverton, and so I was very happy working full-time in Draper when my boss said, I need you to work at least part-time in Salt Lake. And to be honest with you, at first, this really bothered me because my initial reaction was, well, clearly he doesn't trust me. He works in Salt Lake, and he wanted me to work near him because he doesn't think I'm getting any work done or I'm not being as effective as I could be here in Draper. But that's only because he didn't publicize his intentions. When I found out, he said, no, it's because the rest of our training unit and the rest of our team is here, and it makes it easier for us to communicate. Well, I was perfectly happy with that. That made a lot of sense to me. But until those intentions were publicized, there was that element of mistrust, or I felt that trust had been broken. So intentions matter quite a bit here. Quite a bit. So the last thing is, once you have those pure intentions, and only you can purify those things, you want to make sure that your behavior is guiding is being guided by those intentions. Okay, very interesting here from a British psychologist. He says, having spent many years trying to define the essentials of trust, I arrived at the position that if two people say two things to each other and mean them, then there was a basis for real trust. The two things were, I mean you no harm, and I seek your greatest good. I love that. The idea that, and I don't, look, as a supervisor, I don't want to go walk into your next team meeting and say, by the way, guys, I mean you no harm. But what do we? How can we apply that to a supervisory situation? They have to feel that you're not there to get them fired. Your goal is not to make them unsuccessful, but your greatest goal is to help them be as successful as possible. And similarly here from Herb Kelleher, he's the CEO, founder, I believe, of Southwest Airlines. He says, I feel that you have to be with your employees through all their difficulties and that you have to be interested in them personally. I want them to know that Southwest will always be there for them. And I certainly am someone who has relied on my organization quite a few times. I've had to rely on them for health issues and other things, and I've always felt trusted, and I've always felt that I could trust them, that they had my best interest at heart. That goes a long way of producing those behaviors that we saw at the beginning of increased productivity, more organizational citizenship behaviors, all those positive things that we can't do without. By the way, here are a couple of examples of people that do not trust, right? This is Skillet and Lay from Enron. These are people whose intentions, whose motives were not pure. They did not care what happened to the bottom staff at Enron. Right, they got away with their golden parachutes, and people's lives were ruined at Enron because the intentions of the leaders at the top, they were not pure.